No, it is evil eye. Before you think of a doctor, you know, subhanAllah, you need to do ruqya for him. Okay? Why? Because one of the symptoms, early symptoms, is, you know, subhanAllah, you know, significant, okay, change in the situation of a person who, from being, you know, well, into suddenly, you know, subhanAllah, being unwell. Happy, suddenly become very gloomy and upset and, you know, subhanAllah, unbearable. Okay? From loving and caring into suddenly, you know, subhanAllah, hating everyone who's around him. Okay? Hating his wife. Suddenly, hating his children. He's hating his mom, his parents. He cannot take them anymore. His friends. You know that this is, do not relate it to anything else. This is a problem either with jinn or with, you know, subhanAllah, magic or with evil eye. And it is something true. It's not like, well, you know, subhanAllah, do not talk about this because you people are confusing, you know, subhanAllah. We are talking about certain things that when people don't know their symptoms, okay, will suffer for long time before they, you know, subhanAllah, accept it and they submit, okay, to the reality and come ask, you know, subhanAllah, for help. Okay, so before the damage is even really serious, then we need to know about them, okay? It's not for, you know, subhanAllah, for us actually diagnosing and trying to, you know, implement them or, you know, relate them to ourselves, but at least, inshallah ta'ala, to know them. So if we see any kind of change within, you know, subhanAllah, our, immediate members of family, okay, or friends, then inshallah ta'ala, we can know that. Sisters, inshallah ta'ala, if you have any questions, write them and give them to Hafsa, inshallah ta'ala, to pass them to us. Jazakallah khairan.
Can you give us a brief of how one can do self-ruqya?
Ruqya. Okay, beautiful.
Before a bunch of somebody else.
Jazakallah khairan, inshallah ta'ala. Okay, how can a person, you know, perform ruqya upon himself? Yeah? What's ruqya and how do we perform? There is no specific verses of Quran called the Quran of, you know, or the verses of ruqya. Okay? The whole Quran is shifa and remedy and cure. Okay? So we remain with one thing. What's your intention? Your intention. Okay? As we said, the Quran will benefit you, inshallah ta'ala, when you have a specific, okay, intention. You want guidance? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, seek for guidance here, it will guide you. You want peace and tranquility? Read the Quran and it will give you peace and, you know, subhanahu wa ta'ala, tranquility. You want shifa? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have included, alhamdulillah, shifa here in the Quran. Okay? Read the book of Allah Azza wa Jal with that intention. As Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala said, okay, this is, you know, subhanahu wa ta'ala talking from his own experience. When he said, I have been afflicted with illness in my stomach. You know Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala? Okay? He wasn't only a mufassir, muhaddith, faqih. He was a doctor. And whoever sees, you know, subhanAllah, his book, okay? The prophetic medicine. Okay? Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyya, Abu Abd al-Rahman. Okay? Whoever sees his book, Tibb al-Nabawi or the prophetic medicine, then he would know that this person, at that time, he was highly qualified and experienced in such thing. Okay? He said, I have been afflicted with, you know, subhanAllah, stomach problem that nobody could even diagnose it. And you know one thing which is very important for us to know. There is no doctor who will be qualified in order for him to diagnose himself or treat himself. The first ruling, okay, when you go to the school of medicine is you are not allowed legally to diagnose yourself or treat yourself. That's why I have many friends who are, general practitioner. Okay, I ask them, you know, because I had one of my friends, I was really ill and upset, you know, subhanAllah, yani at home, and he came to visit me, okay? And he said, why don't you come to my clinic, inshallah ta'ala, so I will check with you. I said, why do I have to come into it? Is it a business now? I said, you are here. He said, no, you have to come into my clinic. I said, billahi, by Allah, do you ask your wife to come into your clinic when she is... He said to me, no, before you continue, my wife doesn't even really trust me.
She doesn't even really, you know, subhanAllah. If at home, if I say, oh, you have, she said, no, I don't have anything. With you, no, I don't want. He said to me, there is no, oh, you know, subhanAllah, a friend of his who is a doctor, okay, who by any means one day diagnosed his, you know, subhanAllah, children. Okay? In the same clinic, he have quite few, you know, friends who are doctors. So his wife is registered with that, you know, doctor, and that doctor's family is registered with him, and that is always with the doctors. I don't know if we have a doctor here. And maybe say no, except me. Okay? Come. صلاة العصر. نكمل؟ طيب إن شاء الله تعالى. قد أكمل هذه النقطة بعدين نواصل إن شاء الله. Okay? So doctor cannot, you know, diagnose himself. So this is what happened to Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala. He went everywhere to the doctors. And they could not even really know what is his problem is. Okay? So he said, you know, subhanAllah, at that time I went to Mecca. He traveled. You know from where? Where did Muqayyim rahimahullah ta'ala used to live? Damascus, from Syria. He traveled, you know, subhanAllah, to Mecca. And he said, I, you know, subhanAllah, stayed for a few days eating nothing because of the stomach problem that I had, except the Zamzam water and Surah Al-Fatiha. Nothing else. Surah Al-Fatiha. I recite, he blow, okay, in the water and you drink. He said, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured my illness. You remember the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, وَمَا أَدْرَكَ أَنَّهَا الرُّقِيَةِ. Who told you that this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha, is ruqya? He wasn't wondering. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not asking him a question. But he's like, you know, subhanAllah, يعني, okay, conforming. How do you know? How do you know that? Okay, that this is, yeah, you're right. You remember when the incidents that Abu Musa al-Ash'ari rahimahullah ta'ala did ruqya to one of the non-believers, okay, which give you as well the same hadith, okay, confirmation that ruqya can benefit even the non-Muslims. Let alone that, even non-Muslim does a ruqya for a Muslim from something that it does not contain any shirk and kufr, okay, but the tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal, okay, it will still benefit him. Okay, so it is when you link or attach the heart of someone with Allah Azza wa Jal. So when you are, inshallah ta'ala, you know, truly, you know, dependent, you know, subhanAllah, on Allah Azza wa Jal, and your expectation is so high, and you remember the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith al-Qudsi, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Azza wa Jal said, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي فَلْيَظُنَّ بِي مَا شَاءَ. I am accordingly to how my servant think of me. Then let him think of me what he wants. So you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a curer. Allah Azza wa Jal is going to cure me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to remove my illness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to remove my stress. Okay, and you recite that, you know, subhanAllah, whatever verses that comes in your mind, the Fatiha, Ayat al-Kursi, the end of Surah al-Baqarah, then we awe that, inshallah ta'ala, in a water and you blow and you drink, inshallah ta'ala, and you repeat that, okay, constantly, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove your stress and remove your illness, inshallah ta'ala, bidhni Allah.
Are we praying Asr and then we continue?
Yeah, na'am, inshallah, bidhni Allah.
Just very briefly, what if that person is resulted to all the medical forms before he applies
It doesn't matter at all. Okay? Inshallah. At all, inshallah, bidhni Allah Azza wa Jalla. Okay, we stop here, inshallah, ta'ala, for Salat al-Asr, and then we continue. Jazakumullah khairan. كلها سبحان الله العياذ بالله يعني سبحان الله الأخوات ما حيكون موجودات الآن يعني طيناهم بريك
يسمع حتى في البريك
حتى في البريك طيب بس ان شاء الله.
Please the brothers don't go downstairs because there are sisters downstairs in shame.
Okay. فراوينا.
Question.
Okay, هذا للنساء.
No.
This for the sisters, so when they come back.
I think they come here.
ان شاء الله لما يرجعوا بعدين على راحتهم ان شاء الله. Okay. Brothers. Any question?
My question is about Taoism.
Okay. What to do with him? Okay, yes, of course. In case if there is somebody who is possessed, okay, or you know they have a problem with magic and you know jinn, definitely they will never cooperate. It doesn't mean that if somebody cooperated immediately, okay, no, he's a good, he doesn't have any problem. No, it happened in most cases. If somebody is possessed by, you know, the jinn, then he will not let him, you know, subhanAllah, ask for any kind of assistance, or neither the person will be cooperating with the people who are near to him, okay, or he himself will not be able by any means actually to find it easy to go regularly for ruqyah. Sometime if somebody has to go through a matter of ruqyah, okay, it is not a straightforward. Nobody in this earth now has the hand of Isa alayhi salam, okay, or nobody is stopped. Now it's working right. Oh. Okay, now it's working. Sometimes it takes up to 2 to 3 years. So we don't have the hand of Isa alayhi salam that Bismillah, okay, in the name of Allah, and the problem of gone. This is a miracle from Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay? So some of these cases, for one reason, takes half an hour and that's it. It's less, some cases even not half an hour. It just takes somebody to do ruqyah for him as soon as he sees the, you know, subhan, maybe the raqi or something, and that's it. The jinn flee. Woo, that's it. Alhamdulillah, the first time is gone. And sometimes it takes between 2 to 3 years.
10 years.
Sometime 10 years. Okay? So this is ibtila from Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay? We said na'am, we have to accept. We have to, you know, subhanAllah, yani, you know, organize ourselves to coexist with the problem. And at the same time, we have to take all the means, inshallah ta'ala, to remove this. Okay? So it doesn't mean that, well, I've been going for this, you know, subhanAllah, you know, for ruqya to this place for, I don't know, 6 months, you know, subhanAllah, a year. So maybe it's not, you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not write the, you know, subhanAllah, the shifa in this hand, and, you know, or in this, you know, with this person. The mushafi is Allah Azza wa Jal. Every time you go for ruqya, bi'idhni Allah Azza wa Jal, you are rewarded. You are rewarded for your patience. You are rewarded for planning, inshallah ta'ala, to get better, because you have to be better in order for you to worship Allah Azza wa Jal comfortably. Means, if somebody give you in winter cold water to make wudu with and hot water, as a Muslim, which one should you choose?
Cold water.
Hot. Why? Can somebody explain to us? Easy, isn't it? Does it belong? Is it beloved to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala to have everything easy in your life? Can you justify that from a hadith or ayah? Jazakallah khairan. One hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you know, the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, ma khuyira an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bayna amrayn illa akhtara aysaruhuma. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will not be given a choice between two things except that he would choose which one?
The easiest.
Aha. Hadith of Aisha.
There is another hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha when she said, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا الْأَجْرُ عَلَىٰ قَدْرِ الْمَشَقَّةِ Reward is accordingly to the hardship. Aisha, she said, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will not be given a choice of two things, except that this is difficult. He will not choose it. He will choose the easy. Who can...
You don't put yourself in hardship.
Jazakallah khairan. Best, that's it. Okay? You don't choose the hard. But if the easy becomes hard upon you specifically at the time that it is easy for everyone here, okay? Do you think that everybody will be rewarded the same as how you are experiencing the difficulties with that easy thing, isn't it? All of us, we go to Hajj. Okay? So all of us, mashallah, young, apart from Abu Muhammad. Okay, and Abu Muhammad find Hajj very difficult this year. It's too hot, brother, mashallah. It's too hot. And you are coming to comfort him. You're coming from there because you passed him a while ago. Okay, you come. Abu Muhammad, mashallah, tabarakallah. I see you. There is a lot of reward for you, inshallah ta'ala. Come, catch with us. I can't walk because I haven't been walking, you know, for a long time in London. I'm sitting. Okay, so it is easy upon you and difficult upon Abu Muhammad. But did he choose, in fact, okay, to put himself in this situation? No. Okay? But that easy thing for everyone, if it becomes difficult upon somebody, means because of the advance of age, okay, because of the illness that they have. So this is uncontrolled, isn't it? Okay? So that difficulty, which is, you know, unavoidable, you cannot avoid it, okay, brings more reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Isn't it? Now, if somebody is afflicted, come and say, oh, Ibrahim alayhi salam said, فَإِذَا مَرِدْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ If I became ill, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives me shifa. So I'm not going to go to a doctor. No. Why? Because this will affect my tawakkul, my dependency. Again, there is where in the hadith that confuses a lot of people, the hadith of Ukasha, Sahih al-Bukhari. Okay? When Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Ukasha, sabaqaka biha Ukasha, or to one of the companions, you remember? When Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, 70,000 of my ummah will enter Jannah without any accountability. They will never be accounted. Straight away from the mahshar, okay, where people will be gathered, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command the angels to call their names, 70,000. Another hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَاسْتَزَدْتُ اللَّهِ فَزَادَنِي I asked Allah Azza wa Jal for more. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised me with more. With every single one of those 70,000, another 70,000. So multiply it, 70,000 times 70,000. Okay? Anyway, those people will be called. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, straight to Jannah, VIP. There is no VIP in the hadith, okay? Don't quote me on this. Okay, means straight away, you are the guest of Allah Azza wa Jal. Your name in the list, you will not be, okay, accountable. Come on. Where did he live? From 2000 to 2008. I was living in Good Maze. How did he used to live? Wallahi, he was working in... B&Q. Is there anybody here? Okay, Pizza Hut. Now, I used to run my own business, Allah. Halal or haram? How many percentage of haram? Hadith of لا تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة حتى يسأل عن أربع. None of the, you know, children of Adam or the, you know, human beings will be able to walk, okay, or to move 1 inch until they are able to present answer for the four serious questions, ultimate questions for every single one. You're earning. From where were they and where did you spend them, isn't it? Yes? Remember the hadith, okay? So now somebody would come, according to that hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith of Ukasha, which with every single, you know, one of those 70,000, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give another 70,000, so 70,000 times 70,000, okay? Those people will enter Jannah. And what is their qualities or the criteria that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam given, he said, لا يكتوون ولا يسترقون ولا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. Okay? They would not ask somebody to perform ruqya for them. Not, you know, they will be subjecting themselves to for cultivation, they call it, you know, when you heat the iron. Cauterization. Okay? Neither though they will depend on other than Allah Azza wa Jal. So here there is a lot of Muslims, they get confused. They say, but Rasulullah said that those 70,000 they would not ask for ruqya. The same thing when a Muslim comes to you and say, I will not go to a doctor. Why? Because if I go to a doctor, then this affects my tawakkul on Allah Azza wa Jal. And I am supposed to be having tawakkul on Allah Azza wa Jal. Isn't it? Okay? So, فَإِذَا مَرِدْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. If I became ill, then Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who to cure me. Sit at home and that's it. Wait for Allah Azza wa Jal. Wallahi, this person will never say that when it comes to rizq. To the end of the month when there is no rent, okay, money for, you know, paying his rent, he would not say, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send somebody. Somebody. Okay, or someone. Check will come, inshallah, Azza wa Jal. Do you think he would say that? No, he said, no, there is no tawakkul here. Okay, this will, you know, subhanahu wa ta'ala, affect my tawakkul in Allah Azza wa Jal if I'm sitting. No, I have to. The real tawakkul is if I go and earn my rizq, okay, so that I can cover my needs, isn't it? The same thing with when it comes to your cure. Okay, but this hadith of the 70,000, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said they don't ask for ruqya. Yeah, when somebody has no problem at all. Because the ruqya is two type, preventative, and this is where the problem comes. Okay, all this ta'weez is majority preventative, isn't it? Yeah? Yes or no? Before anything happens. If you have this, then there is no ayn is going to affect you. There is no sihr is going to affect you. There is no jinn. يعني preventative, يعني معناتها وقاية, حماية. حماية قبل أن يقع الأمر. Okay? طيب؟ للوقاية, وهذا حرام. وهذه الرقية للوقاية, طيب؟ هي ممنوعة في الشرع. Okay? أو هي التي تحرم الإنسان من الدخول في 70,000. The preventative ruqya, if somebody doesn't have anything and he comes and say to his brother, okay, brother, can you do ruqya for me? Then he is preventing himself or depriving himself from being of those 70,000, okay? But when somebody is afflicted, you have a problem here. For you to ask, you know, subhan, ruqya is sometime obligatory, wajib. Why? Because Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ دَاءً إِلَّا وَأَنزَلَ لَهُ دَوَى عَلِمَهُ مَنْ عَلِمَ وَجَهِلَ مَنْ جَهِلَ فَتَدَاوُوا يَا عِبَادَ اللَّهُ وَلَا تَدَاوُوا بِحَرَامٍ. There is no illness, okay, that Allah have created except He have created beside it its remedy and its cure and its medicine. Okay? When the time for it come to be known, then it will be known. Okay? When the time is not, then it is not. It will not be discovered, neither it will be known. So Rasulullah said, immediately he said, فَتَدَوُوا يَا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ. All servants of Allah, you know, seek for your cure. So seeking cure, medicine, okay, a remedy for your own problem, becomes what? Huh? Becomes? Not recommended. Becomes? Obligatory. Why? Why? Go back again to usul al-fiqh. الواجب يع... أو... الأمر يحمل للوجوب إلا إذا جاءت قرينة تصرفه عن الوجوب للندب. All forms of command in the Quran or Sunnah should be taken immediately for what? For wajib. All forms. When Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said do immediately, what does it mean? What does it mean? Wajib. Immediately. The way, the same hadith when Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said معشر الشباب من استطاع منكم الباءة فليتزوج. All group of youth, whoever from among you can afford, then let him get married. This is emphasized wajib, not even wajib. Emphasized. Why? Because أمرٌ سبق بفاء الطلب. فاء تزوجوا. فاء تزوجوا. تزوجوا is get married. But there is فاء before it. That فاء is to emphasize the importance of implementing this obligation, the obligatory that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is directing you to it. The same thing here. When Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ما أنزل الله داء إلا وأنزل له دواء علمه من علمه جاهل أو من جاهله فتداو. تداو is seek your cure. Ask for, you know, subhanAllah, for remedy and cure. But it came, okay, in an emphasized form of obligation by Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying fa tadaw. So that fa came to emphasize this, you know, the importance of you know, the wujub. طيب, shall we take the break now or we'll take the break after half an hour, or we shouldn't take a break? Of course. Take the break now. Vote. Finish the point. Of course, no, I have to finish the point, even if you are going now. Jazakallah khairan. Okay, inshallah ta'ala. So anyway, inshallah, after this, you know, answering this question, then we go, inshallah ta'ala, for break, and then we continue after that. Okay? Okay. So now, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us actually to seek our cure. Okay? Now, when somebody come and say, Ya akhi, when I am ill, okay, where is my tawakkul on Allah Azza wa Jal? Where is my tawakkul on Allah? Okay, in order for me to be with those 70,000, I shouldn't ask for, you know, subhanAllah, you know, ruqya. We say, Ya akhi, the ruqya is two type. Preventative is that which you don't need. You are not, you know, in need of it at this point. But you've heard about the beauty of ruqya, the benefits of ruqya. Like what? Like the hijama. You know, just to make it simple for you to understand. Hijama is two type, isn't it? Cupping. Preventative, sunnah. Somebody have heard about hijama. And there is books now, isn't it? So people, when we used to talk about hijama 10 years ago, people, they used to say, oh, you know, subhanAllah, this is unhygienic. I don't think it is from the sunnah. Now everybody wants to do it, isn't it? Now, there is people who are afflicted, they are ill. And they have been ill for quite some time. And they've been to all doctors and, you know, subhanAllah, they've been through, you know, different medicines. And it did not help them. So we say, do you remember that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, hijama shifa'un min sab'una da? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do you know that hijama is shifa? He did not say dawa. Okay, so after the break, inshallah ta'ala, we mention the difference between shifa and dawa, remedy and shifa, because shifa, it doesn't have any alternative direct, you know, synonym, okay, word from English, okay, that covers the meaning of shifa. You have, in Arabic we say dawa, okay, you have remedy, medicine, okay, cure is the same, but shifa has to remain the way how it is. Untouchable. Why? Because there is no way that in English, unless if you use a sentence to explain what is shifa is, there is no, okay, word that can immediately, okay, give us the same meaning of the Arabic word shifa. Okay? So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to you when you are ill and you've been to doctors, say Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do you know that cupping has shifa from 70 different type of illnesses? Until now, the illnesses that, you know, subhanAllah, shifa, sorry, cupping treats, okay, have reached to, you know, 15 or 16, okay, and all of this is untreatable with any other medicine. And we know a medicine, take it from me, okay, doctors, they always treat symptoms. يداوون الأعراض لا يداوون الأمراض. Doctors are able to treat symptoms. I feel pain here because of that illness. Immediately will give you, okay, medicine that kills what?
Pain.
The symptoms, the pain. So it doesn't anymore appears. And you think what? You've been treated. Okay? Go to whatever is mentioned in the Quran or Sunnah, okay, with shifa, and you find that whenever that is obtained, the illness is gone once and forever, and it will never come back. And you'd find, inshallah ta'ala, many ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of them, okay, though it comes in the form of, you know, preventative, more than a cure, whenever you see somebody who's afflicted with illness, any illness, okay, and you see that person, he have diabetic, inshallah ta'ala, we are not trying to, you know, show that we are not, you know, sympathetic to, you know, the brothers who have that. But what I meant is to the healthy brother, okay? Or the person who is, you know, complaining for certain illnesses. There is other illnesses which he might be exposed to, isn't it? So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you see somebody who's afflicted in front of you and you say, Alhamdulillah, alladhi afani mimma btalaka bihi wa faddalani ala kathiri min khalqihi tafdila, except that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this person will live for the remaining time of his life in this dunya without being exposed to that illness. Even if normally he's supposed to be, you know, subhanAllah, afflicted with such, with that dua will prevent him and he will never face this. Okay, and the translation of that dua is, okay, Allahumma, you know, all praise to you, O Allah, I thank you. Okay? Alhamdulillah, الذي فضلني على كذا. The one who have, you know, made me to be better. Okay, or to be favored me. Jazakallah khair. Okay, favored me. Okay, and prevented me, protected me from whatever he have afflicted you. So you don't face it. You don't tell him in his face. I don't care, go to him and say, Alhamdulillah, الذي عفاني مما ابتلاك به. That is not good adab, is it? But within yourself. Okay? Somebody have, you know, subhanAllah, you've heard. Okay, you've been, you know, subhanAllah, ill with whatever illness, whatever it is, that you fear Allah Azza wa Jal, you know, subhanAllah, to face that, you know, subhanAllah, يعني illness. Say, Alhamdulillah, الذي فضلني. Alhamdulillah, the one who have favored me and protected me from whatever he have afflicted you with. And he have, you know, subhanAllah, made me to be, you know, above many of his creation. Okay, because you thank Allah Azza wa Jal, there is many people who are lower than you in life, isn't it? Okay, فضلنا على كثير من خلقي تفضيلا. And he have, you know, subhanAllah, favored me and completed his favors upon me. Alhamdulillah. Okay, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, nobody would say this dua. And this is in your dua that most of you, alhamdulillah, maybe carries in his pocket, which is small Husn al-Muslim, isn't it? Okay, the fortress of the Muslim. You have it? You should have it, inshallah, if you don't. Okay? So, if you say that dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you. So that is part of ruqyah. That's part of, you know, subhanAllah, medicine, okay, in a such way. So hijama, okay, is cure and shifa from many illnesses, okay, 70. Specifically, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned 70 different type of illnesses that will not be cured except with what? With hijam. So those people who were, you know, subhanAllah, going from one doctor to another, to, you know, subhanAllah, from one hospital to another, they were hospitalized, they were hospitals, and they are still suffering. We said to them, ya, why don't you do hijam? So those type of people, do they need hijam or not? They need. So for them, you break all the instructions that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam given. Because the instruction that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam given is for the one who wants to perform it as what? As sunnah. Number one, it is better if it is on the 17th, 19th, 21 of every Islamic calendar month, isn't it? This is for whom? For the one who wants, you know, he have option. When should I do it? Say, inshallah, come on 17th, 19th, 21, if you wanted to get, you know, maximum benefit of hijama. Okay? Don't do it in daytime. In the evening. Do it in the daytime. Why? Because it is hot. And do it in summer. Don't do it in winter. Okay? Do it in, you know, subhanAllah, empty stomach. Don't do it while you are full. Don't drink such, you know, kind of drinks, okay, after you've done the hijama. Okay? Don't have relationship with your wife for such and such, you know, period of time. This is for whom? For the one who wants to do it as a sunnah. I want to do it. I want to refresh my memory. I want to refresh my blood circulating system. I feel a bit lazy. I feel, you know, drowsy. I feel, you know, sleepy. But I don't have any kind of illness. Okay? Do hijama, brother. Okay, that is very good. It is like, do, you know, take your car for service. Service for your, you know, service yourself. Your body, isn't it? That's good. But when somebody is ill, anytime. Why? Because he needs it. You don't say, well, you know, like, oh, the instruction, the strict, you know, the instructions or the, you know, the, you know, the, you know, the timing and so on and so on. That's, it doesn't apply for this space. And the same thing with when it comes to ruqya. Ruqya, somebody would come and say, well, I want to do ruqya because I've heard it is so nice and so good and mashallah, tabarakallah. We say, you don't need it, brother. But if somebody offered it to you, you say, yeah. Why? Because you didn't ask it. You didn't ask for it. Because the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to be from the 70,000 people, he said they don't ask for ruqya. But if somebody offered them, he say, oh, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. I was asking for it inside me, but I didn't want to ask somebody to do it for me because I still want to be with the 70. Yes, can I sit here and you do ruqya for me? Okay, so that's why from the sunnah of you knowing your brother when he's not feeling well, before he asks you for ruqya, you got to even say, inshallah ta'ala, I don't see you well these days. You don't know. So let us, inshallah ta'ala, make you know, ruqya for you. You don't expect now, as you are doing ruqya, that he's going to shout and kick and talk, you know, subhanAllah, in a funny voice, and okay, maybe there is jinn. No. He's not feeling well. Okay, whatever, you know, subhanAllah, is stressing him, ruqya is beneficial, and you do ruqya for him. Is that okay? Ruqya is for everything. Tamam? How do we perform it? There is no specific verses of the Quran that are, you know, called the verses of the ruqya. Okay, the whole Quran is, inshallah ta'ala, yes, na'am, shifa. Okay, and if you are performing so for somebody, then you follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, touching what? Front head, and you're sighting his air, okay, as close as possible. Okay, upon yourself, you don't have to do. You don't have to. Okay, just recite, inshallah ta'ala, the Quran. And you blow in water, you drink, have a bath, inshallah ta'ala, every now and then. Inshallah, this will remove, okay, any affliction that you have. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Have we answered the question? Exactly. Okay, I think you deserve a break now. But whoever wants to remain with us, inshallah ta'ala, for, you know, we can. Okay, and we see, inshallah ta'ala, after 10 minutes.
Yeah, bring it,
inshallah ta'ala. Jazakallah khairan. Hayyakallah wa hamza. Kif al-hal? How are you? Are you okay? Allah ihfadhak, inshallah.
I was going to ask you, when is the best time to see it? Because I came there once.
Okay, so one of the sisters asked a question for Sheikh Abu Hanifa. It says, Bismillah, assalamu alaikum. A year ago, I suddenly suffered from anxiety attacks. And it was diagnosed as stress, even though I wasn't stressed. I saw in a dream my little finger tied into a knot, but I could only see the hands that tied it. This all happened after my mom saw in a dream I had divorced. I saw huge spiders and snails in the dreams frequently. I experienced migraine and still do as well as feeling sick. What is the significance of this, inshallah? Jazakallah khair.
Inshallah, jazakallah khair. طيب جزاك الله خير إن شاء الله تعالى. Now number one, I don't even really know whether the sister was married and she was divorced within the same period where her mother saw the dream. Okay, dreams do have meaning. Okay, and have some significant indications to many things that will happen to us in the future, but you will not have a full explanation from the person that is, for example, meant to be interpreting the dream, unless if you know a lot, you know, of information of your present life. Okay? Now, there is, I think, a book that has been translated from Arabic to English of Ibn Sirin. Okay, they attribute it to Ibn Sirin, but it's not Ibn Sirin's book, for sure. because Ibn Sirin used to be muhaddith, and he used to be from among ulama of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and there is in that book many things that contradicts actually with the basic principles of the Aqeedah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, which shows you that this could not be written by somebody who have that high standard of knowledge as the knowledge of Ibn Sirin. So automatically we know that this is not Ibn Sirin's book. Okay, number two, there is no benefit whatsoever from that book. Okay, why? Because it might be dreams that he have translated, okay, or interpreted for many people in his own time. For the sake of argument, if he said that this is his book. But we can never take this as a formula to say, well, if somebody saw blackbird in his dream, that means such and such. It doesn't mean. Okay? It's not necessarily. I saw myself, I was traveling, so does it mean in the, in a subhanAllah such a stage will happen to me in my life? Not necessarily. Okay? As let alone, you know, subhanAllah, that this is not a straightforward matters, even if 2, 3, 4, 10 people, okay, at the same time saw the same dream, come to somebody to interpret it for them, he would give 10 different meaning for those 10 different people. Each one of those, okay, would have dreamt of completely different thing, okay, or the meaning of his own dream is completely different than the other 9, okay? At the time that all of them have seen one type of dream, okay? And how would this person interpret them differently, okay? After he have, or after he asks certain questions which are related to, you know, the person's, you know, present affairs, okay? Or current, you know, situation of his own life, okay? So there is many things that we, you know, subhanAllah, are incomplete on this in this question. But I would say, if this the sister is worried, okay, as it has come in the end of the question, I'm still suffering from migraine and you know, stomach upset and so on and so. And so far we say, okay, sister, do ruqya for yourself, okay, or if you find, inshallah ta'ala, somebody to do ruqya for you, if you think that this is related to this issue, okay, then inshallah ta'ala you would find the answer. Wallahu alam. But you know, the dreams or whatever you have seen are incomplete, so we cannot say, well, you know, they mean this or they mean that. Wallahu ta'ala alam.
Okay.
Wallahu alam.
Okay, another question, inshallah. Says, my husband is afflicted with a jinn and it has been diagnosed. He is okay but suffers from sleep problem. What can he do? Also, what can I do as a wife to help him and support him through this? And what should I avoid?
Okay.
Avoid
absolutely rice and curry and fish, chicken, lamb, bread. Just joking. Okay? What would you avoid? Nothing. Okay? Avoid not praying on time, avoid not doing dhikr, avoid, you know, absolutely doing nothing that upsets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, this situation has happened to us just because we've been far away from Allah azza wa jal. We have to take it this way. In order for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lift this affliction away, then we have to, okay, strengthen our iman. Okay, the closer we are to Allah azza wa jal, inshallah, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove this. Always we say there is 6 different occasional dua that a person must, it's wajib upon you to do. Okay, number one, because they are the, you know, part of the daily obligation that a Muslim should do. In the other hand, it is, inshallah ta'ala, for your own security. Many people would say, what is it that we should do to avoid being afflicted with jinn, evil eye, and sihr, and so on and so forth? You say, well, you find this, inshallah ta'ala, on this daily dua that you do, on 6 different occasions. Number one, dua before you sleep. This is part of the duty of the Muslim. Okay? Dua before you sleep. Okay? Dua when you wake up. The, you know, the means the supplication before sleep, supplications after you get up, inshallah ta'ala, from your sleep, supplications of morning, supplications of evening, supplication when you are getting into the house, when you are coming out of the house. Each of those supplications, if you look into them, they are related into, you know, preserving you and protecting you from harm that you are unable to deal with. Okay? Always. So, those six different occasion, okay, or occasional du'as. Supplications of morning, supplications of
evening.
Supplications before you
sleep,
and supplication immediately when you
wake
up. Supplication when you are leaving your house, when you are getting into the house. Okay? Absolutely, the other ones after Salah and, you know, Subhanallah, the you know, after Maghrib is more, and after Fajr, including Ayatul Kursi, because those are, I think all of us, we do them. But we are talking about those things that we think, okay, they are occasional. No, they are not occasional. Those six different occasional du'as are very important, inshallah ta'ala, that we don't do them, you know, mostly. And we have to, inshallah ta'ala, teach our children, okay, to do them. The rest is really occasional. When you are traveling, the dua of traveling, the dua of rain, the dua of facing enemy, the dua, you know, they don't happen that much. But because you have your dua book in your pocket, whenever you are facing that occasion, you take this book and read that dua, inshallah ta'ala, as a Muslim. Okay, have your trust in Allah Azza wa Jalla after you have tied your camel. Then inshallah ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save you from all kind of harm. Wallahu alam. Okay? Of course, you know, what should you do, you know, if the husband is, you know, having afflicted with the, you know, the, you know, jinn problem, and, okay, absolutely, either people will